in the world.
Those are the speakers.
Just Give Me Jesus
keys
by
are,
Grandma.
That's the piano.
Read it, you know what I'm talking about. There are some details and a way of explaining the crucifixion, resurrection, that I've never seen in any other way. And so I'm going to share that with you in the next few weeks. I've been really excited about reading it and understanding, taking step by step what happened in the trials, in the crucifixion, the resurrection, those kinds of things. And I think it has just challenged me and it blessed me tremendously just to even read it. So that's where I'm headed today. Last time we worked on, or looked at, Judas being the betrayer. Remember that? And Judas did not get an opportunity to have his sins forgiven. Well, he had an opportunity, he just didn't take it. He threw, threw the silver instead of falling down at Jesus' feet and asking for forgiveness.
Look at his head.
So now he's spending his time in a nice warm place. As we continue with that story, the Roman cohort, which was 100 or so people, grab Jesus and they have him bound. Okay, remember we found that? So in John 18:12, it says, so the Roman cohort and the commander and the officers of the Jews arrested Jesus and bound him and led him to Annas first. For he was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the high priest that year. Now, I never paid that much attention to the high priest. Speaking loud is making this good money. But in the Old Testament, the high priest, remember, was the descendant of who? Of Aaron, of the tribe of Levi. Okay, Aaron, who was the tribe of Levi. He was appointed to that position by God. And his job was to mediate between God and man. He was kind of the mediator between man and God by giving the sacrifice, the yearly sacrifice for the atonement for the sin of people, and to intercede on God's, on behalf of God's children when they had issues going on. It was a sacred, solemn, and sanctified position in the eyes of God and in the eyes of the people. Very, very important person. And that's what it was designed to be. However, in the Roman occupation, the position of high priest turned to be turned out to be a political position. Time out. Alright. Now, this position became so more important than any political position, because when the Romans came, they wouldn't let any political leaders take over. They couldn't. They wanted to be sure that they had complete control, and so they allowed the high priest to take over the kind of the political thing. And then, of course, because of that, it became a position that was purchased. And it was purchased by the wealthy Annas, who was a very extremely wealthy man. And he was appointed the high priest, and then he started dipping into the temple treasury to take care of other things. And then he put all his sons in as high priests, and his son-in-law's in high priest, so it became a family. So, if you understand that, you understand why it seems a little crooked? As you read through the scripture, the man who achieved that position was the one who bribed the Roman officials with the most money. And then he was expected on that hand to keep a tight rein on the Jews, so the Romans didn't have to deal with these troublesome people. They thought the Jews were probably the most troublesome area that they had to deal with. And so by the high priest connecting the political with the religious, the guys got completely. That was the idea. Okay. Well, Annas had been high priest for 9 years at this time.
Nope.
Very wealthy. And each of his sons had rotated the high priest job, acting high priest job. And so Caiaphas, this was Caiaphas' time, his son-in-law's turn, during this particular set. So in Acts 4:6, it says that Annas the high priest was there because they took Jesus to Annas. Okay. They took him to him, to his, I think if I remember right, that there, at the temple area, there was the house of the high priest, I think was somehow connected in there, pretty close by. So they took him to Annas' house first. Okay. And Annas, in Acts 4:6, it says, Annas the high priest was there, and Caiaphas, and John, and Alexander, and all who were of high priestly descent. So you get some names of some of the other sons of Annas, John and Alexander. Okay. And because the Jews had no authority under Roman law to put anybody to death, that became a Roman privilege. They had to come up with a charge against Jesus that the Romans would think was worthy of death. Think about that for a minute. So when they go to Annas starts questioning Jesus, and he has great piety and inquisitiveness. He tries to be very regal. And you see this in John 18:19. Annas questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. Tell us, Jesus, who have you been teaching? What have you been teaching? And Jesus, who had nothing to hide, looks at this man. And in John 18, verses 20 through 21, he says, I have spoken openly to the world. I always taught in synagogues, or at the temple, where all the Jews come together. I said nothing in secret. Why are you asking me? Don't you know these things? Surely you know this. He says, surely you know what I said. Ask people. They can tell you. And Annas, who is trying to be very, very important. In other words, this is what Jesus was saying. Annas, where have you been? I've been teaching publicly in the temple every day this week. You're the former high priest. It's your business to know what's being taught on temple property. You should have been directly informed. Go ask someone who heard about me. Who heard me what I said I am. What I've been saying and whom I'm speaking to. Bless somebody. They all know. And so, can you imagine Annas' look on his face? Nobody talked that way by a priest. we end up with Annas being extremely mad. Okay. Interesting thing about this confrontation that I really hadn't paid attention to this before, but as you look at this, Ann, who wrote this, said this, and I think this is true. He said that when he confronted Annas, Jesus gave the principle that God holds people accountable, not just for what they heard or know, but what they had the opportunity to hear. God holds us accountable for the opportunity of what we could have known. That could make a difference. And if we think about America, what is the opportunity to know about Jesus Christ? There's a big sign on Highway 99, Jesus Saves, I think. It used to be, I think it's still there.
Jesus Saves, I think.
I don't think it says, I think. But I think I don't know. Well, but think about how many churches there are in Fresno. One on every corner, just about, along with Starbucks. Too many markets, right? But think of the religious radio broadcast, the TV broadcast, the Bible studies on video, written Bible commentaries, magazines, stories. Christian churches, Christian ministries that are not connected with churches, Christian schools, bookstores, evangelistic crusades. Franklin Graham is coming here before long. Billy Graham has been here. We've had the Promise Keepers. We've had this thing with Mighty Men of somebody professional. Mighty Men movement coming up. Movies. America has a tremendous opportunity. Probably more than many so it said, she said, you know, it doesn't matter if you ever turned in and participated, you have the opportunity to do so. And I know that I've read and heard people who have just turned into a TV program. Talked to somebody once who had just was flipping the channels and Billy Graham was on and they got hooked on and found Christ that night. Same thing. So Annas, who wants to put Jesus on the defensive, has to explain him to himself. He's on the defensive now. Because what's the matter? Don't you know what's going on? Okay. Now keep going. You know, when you say that to an important official, they don't take it lightly. Because they're embarrassed. Because they're supposed to know what's going on. But you and I all both know that nobody can know everything that's going on, particularly the president, that's for sure. There's no way that you could ever know what's going on. There's no way our pastor can know everything that's going on in the church. We're just lucky we know what's going on in our house. And in my car, you know. But here's an interesting thing. Jesus rebukes Annas, and what happens? Annas' bodyguard goes, ka-wham! From John 18, when he said this, one of the officers standing nearby struck Jesus, saying, is that the way you answer the high priest? And Jesus answered him, if I've spoken wrongly, tell me of the wrong. But if rightly, why do you hit me? Did you know that to strike an unarmed prisoner who had been charged with nothing was against the law? And Annas didn't really care about the law. He only cared about what parts he wanted to care about. He didn't stop this. He ignored it. He went on. He's frustrated. He's humiliated. He expected this man to be cowering before him, and here's a man standing with great authority. He's beat. They've been beaten on him. All kinds of things. Annas then, he admits defeat. I'm not getting this guy to confess. Send him off to Caiaphas. Now, Caiaphas' house was close by. Well, Caiaphas, remember, there's no charge. They still got him. Take him off as a prisoner. In John 18:24, it says, so Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. And now we've been through the first religious trial of Annas. Now he's going to the second religious trial and facing Caiaphas. Okay? About 3 a.m. in the morning, this is. Okay? The first thing, they're looking, trying to find something they can accuse him of. Finding something that maybe they can get him to admit or that he can be accused of, that we can kill him. Something that would be worth the death penalty. Okay. And keep that in mind as you hear all the things that go on. Now in Mark 14 it says, now the chief priests and all council kept trying to obtain testimony against Jesus to put him to death. And they were not finding him. For many were giving false testimony against him, but their testimony was not consistent. Saints trying to get him, but they hire these people to say that. I don't know if you've ever tried to determine whether somebody's lying, especially children. But there's a group of them, two or three of them, and they're trying to what he did this, and I know I did that. But you ever done that? Ever been in that situation? Yeah. Well, I find the best thing to do is to get them aside and get your story, then get your story, then get your story, and then see what happens. But if you tell, you know, Proverbs has a saying that says, any story sounds true until you hear the other side. I like that. So Caiaphas had arranged a kangaroo court with false testimony, ready to go, but the witnesses couldn't even agree. Now it's the middle of the night. They're not supposed to have trials in the middle of the night. Okay? So Caiaphas, who's angry, he stands up, gets Jesus under him. And this is what he says to Jesus. By the living God, tell us if you are the Christ, the Son of God. But Jesus kept silent. high priest said to him, I tell you by the living God that you tell us whether you're the Christ, the Son of God. It was very, very quiet. Everybody's looking. Everybody's waiting for an answer. And then Jesus drops this bomb upon them. With absolute clarity, he knows exactly what he's saying. He's looking at Caiaphas' angry face and the angry faces of the other people and looking for the charge, and he gives them the charge that what he knows when he says this, that he's going to be counted guilty. What does he say? I am he. Yes, I am the Son. He claimed to be the Son of God. And notice he says, I am. When he said, I am in the garden, what happened? They all fell down. I am. He connects himself, though that word is I, yes, I am God. That's what he's saying. Okay? And so that becomes then the charge that they're going to put on him. Okay? Claim to be the Son of God. And if he claimed to be the Son of God, and if he is who he says he is, then he's not a good man. He's not even a great man. He's not even a prophet. He is God in the flesh. Or he's a liar. Or he's a blasphemer. And or he's mentally deranged. Any of those choices. His answer doesn't leave any middle ground. It's either yes or no. He's either God or he's not. Okay. He claimed to be the Son of God. He claimed to be God walking the earth in man's body. What do you think?
Yeah.
I think most of you probably believe that's what he said. That he is what he says. Interesting, though, that he didn't stop with that. If you go to Matthew 26, verse 63, I think, no, 64. Jesus said to him, you have said it yourself. Nevertheless, I tell you, hereafter, you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of the Mighty One and coming on the clouds of heaven. Not only did he say, yes, I am God, you're going to see me in heaven, you're going to see me coming back to earth with judgment. Woohoo! Now that really blew it out. And it's like that moment when everything was quiet and all of a sudden they just explode in anger. And fury. And it says here in Matthew 26, 65 to 66, then the high priest tore his robe and he said, he has blasphemed. What further need do we have of witnesses? Even though they weren't honest. Behold, you have heard the blasphemy. What do you think? He answered, he deserves death. He deserves death. He left the room. Caiaphas left the room. I see a hand back there. I don't know who it is.
Can you explain a little bit more about the word blasphemy?
Blasphemy? No, I can't.
I know that. I know that it probably is a large meaning to that.
Well, what it means is that if you claimed to be God, you were a liar. Yeah. It's the worst thing you can say. It's against God. Satan said, I can be like God. Okay. And that is blasphemy. If you say you are God or like God, then you're blasphemous. I think that's it. And I'm going to go on because I'm trying to get this done. Okay? Alright, so Caiaphas leaves the room. What's he going to do? He goes and calls an official meeting of the Sanhedrin. Now, at 6 o'clock in the morning, they don't have meetings. It's against the law. But they're all there, all dressed up in their robes. And see, meantime, here's Jesus in this room with these guys. What are they doing? Spit on him, pulled his beard out, beat him, yelled at him, hit him in the face. They spit in his face, beat him with their fists, then slapped him. And they said, prophesy to us, you Christ. Who's the one who hit you? Ha ha ha, mocking him. Now by that time, he's beginning to bleed. He's dripping with spit. He's got part of his beard pulled out. And Jesus, with his hands bound, just stood there and allowed himself to be assaulted. That fulfills a prophecy. In Isaiah 50, verses 6 and 7, this is what it says. I gave my back to those who strike me, and my cheeks to those who pluck out the beard. I did not cover my face from humiliation and spitting, for the Lord God helps me. Therefore I am not disgraced. Therefore I have set my face like flint, and I know I will not be ashamed. About 6 o'clock in the morning, the third religious trial begins. So all the chief priests and the elders of the people came to the decision to put Jesus to death. There's a lot of dignity going on here. They did this with great vagueness. Without realizing it, though, this verdict that they were so involved in and so hot to get that verdict, they played into the hands of God. It was exactly predetermined that he was going to die on the cross as a sacrifice for sin. Sometimes God takes the plans of evil men and turns them into something quite important for his plan. And he all remembered that. And that's not unusual. If you look at the Old Testament, you see many times God had said, if you don't behave, you know, if you're misbehaved, I'm going to send these people after you. And the Babylonians came. The Assyrians came. And then the Romans came. And they spread across the world. All those things happened. So we can't necessarily pin it down to one thing. This is God's plan. And if God's plan works out, then all things work for good. Remember, I'm going to finish up with this, that there was one of the men who was standing around, a young man, by the name of Saul, standing there watching this whole thing go on, I'm sure, was not a part at that point, I don't think, was his neighbor, but he was a Pharisee, so he certainly was somewhere around there. Remember that they gave him the job of hunting down these people to follow Christ, called Christians. Along the way to Damascus, he gets this light, the bright light, changes his life, and he goes to Ananias, gets his sight back, gets his name changed to Paul, and he begins to write things. And so then, remember, that Ananias said to Saul, the Lord Jesus, who appeared to you on the road when you were coming, sent me so you can regain your sight and be filled with the Holy Spirit. Immediately there fell from his eyes something like scales and regained his sight. He got up and was baptized. Years later, in 1 Timothy, this is what he said. This is a trustworthy statement, deserving full acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, among whom I am foremost of all. I am. Yet for this reason, I found mercy, so that in me, Jesus Christ, might demonstrate his perfect patience as an example of those who believe in him for eternal life. If God can forgive Saul for murdering and persecuting Christians, he can forgive you. And he can forgive you no matter what your sin is. What about these people who say, Jesus is nothing, he's just wealthy? Will you forgive them if they come to him? Absolutely. And I think Paul's the best example of that. Would Jesus have forgiven those religious leaders who attacked him? They'd ask him, he'd ask him. No? Yes. Yes. Because God forgives sin. And it's only Jesus, through his crucifixion on the cross, that those sins can be paid for. And so when you take a look at this crucifixion and this trial, and we see how God's plan works out, it's kind of a terrible story. But in the end, Who wins? Well, we're thankful for that. Let's pray. What a story. Only God, you could, you're the only one that could have made up this story of persecution and trials and claim, false claims, all this stuff, to get your son to where he needed to be, to take the penalty for our sin. Thank you for this suffering. Help us to remember that you love us so much.